Welcome to the podcast series on National Education Policy 2020 by the Center of Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. For this podcast, we plan to interview educationists and other stakeholders to share their responses and insights on different chapters of the education policy.
Hello everyone, this is Deepti Rona, your host for the day. In today's podcast, we will be taking a look at the Inclusive Education section of the National Education Policy 2020. The podcast will begin with a brief contextualization of the section, followed by the pros and cons of the policy, and a look into what it will take for its implementation. Our two speakers for the day are Dr. Maithili Ramchand and Dr. Radhika Miskita. Dr. Maithili Ramchand is a professor at the Center for Education, Innovation and Action Research, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Before joining TIS, Professor Maithili was the director of Avi Educational Consortium, Bangalore, from 2005 to 2018. She worked as a science teacher educator and a high school physics teacher prior to 2005. Professor Maithili has led a number of collaborative projects and research studies in Karnataka. She has worked on initial teacher education curriculum, developed reading materials, and has been involved in capacity enhancement programs for Faculty of Education. Currently, she anchors a post-graduation certification program for Faculty of Education offered by TIS. Professor has also offered her consultancy to a number of organizations and has been in the panel of committees on teacher education, curriculum renewal and reforms. She is currently a member of the Institutional Advisory Board of Regional Institute of Education, NCRT, Mysore. We are pleased to have you with us today, ma'am. Dr. Radhika Miskita is the co-principal of the Gateway School of Mumbai. She has completed a doctorate in special education, learning disabilities, from the University of Texas, USA. She also has a master's in special education from SNDT Women's University, Mumbai, India. Prior to joining the Gateway School of Mumbai, she has worked in India and the USA as a teacher coach and special educator for over 15 years. It's a pleasure to have you with us today, ma'am. Now over to Professor Maithili Ramchand to take over the discussion.
Hello, everyone. In this podcast, we will be looking at the Inclusive Education section of the National Education Policy 2020. Let me begin by setting the context of the section. So the policy primarily looks at inclusion from the broader perspective of social justice. Unlike the common conception within India of associating inclusive education primarily with persons of disabilities. Globally, the conception of inclusive education as inclusive of all learners who have been traditionally marginalized and disadvantaged into the formal education system was basically highlighted by the Salamanca statement in 1994. So the construct of inclusion as inclusive of everyone, in fact, emerged in 1994 within the global discourse. And the rights perspective that marks international discourses and treaties requires a little more emphasis in this particular document. In fact, India has ratified the United Nations Convention for the Rights of Persons with Disability Treaty that was drafted in 2006, and the subsequent Rights of Persons with Disability Act that was passed in 2016 in India is aligned to this convention. The policy certainly makes a note of this act, RPWD Act, and they fully endorse the act. So by that, it means that the rights perspective is also something that the policy recognizes. And it also endorses the Sustainable Development Goal of the United Nations at the very beginning of the document. And if we look at the other sections, primarily school education, higher education, and teacher education sections, they all include recommendations for addressing needs of the disadvantaged groups, including learners with disabilities. But there are some contradictions that may preclude from true inclusion in practice, such as the tutoring system in school education, the national open schooling option, then vocationalization, flexibility in dropping off from higher education institutions with credits equivalent to certification and diploma requirements. Now, these flexibilities and even vocationalization and national open school are extremely important and valuable in a diverse country like India. But then so far, our experience has shown that these exit options are in fact availed primarily by the disadvantaged communities. And if you look at the enrollment, for example, in the National Institute of Open School in India, a large majority of them are students with disabilities. Therefore, when chalking out the program of action, these points have to be kept in mind. Would you agree, Radhika? And I will also invite you to share your views on the specific recommendations in terms of persons with disabilities, and how do you think they can be brought to fruition without adversely impacting the prospects of children with disabilities?
Yes, absolutely. Thank you, Maithili. That was a great introduction. I think great overview of what was positive with the NEP, and I think where maybe with the when it's executed and the plan of action comes about, what areas we do need to focus on. I'm going to talk a little bit more specifically about the disability through the disabilities lens. I think Maithili, as you rightly said, you know, the rights perspective, I mean, that does come through. And while it endorses the RPWD Act, it's a the terminology is a bit conflicting in places, but we'll talk about that in a little bit. I think I first want to address the positives that I see where this will push us towards inclusion. And one of the first things that I think that the NEP does really well is that it emphasizes teacher education. You know, so there is a heavy emphasis on building the skill set. And very interestingly, they talk about building the skill set of special educators also to be able to be disciplinary specific, to have disciplinary specific skills. Now, why this I feel is really important is that there is this divide between general and special ed in our country. And the reality is on the ground, there is no divide. You know, there's that one child that's trying to be included in the mainstream setting. And there is this unnecessary divide about whom does this child belong to? Who takes ownership for this? And I think what the NEP does really well is it says that, you know, we are working towards inclusion. Everybody, it's a responsibility of all of us. So I really like that the NEP emphasizes the need for special educators to be equipped with the disciplinary specific skills that will allow them to go into the mainstream and co-teach effectively with the general educator. So I think that's one thing that, you know, it emphasizes well. The other thing, like you rightly said, Maithili, it, you know, endorses the RPWD Act. And I think that's the defining act in our country right now. And it does a great job of endorsing all of the recommendations, all of the accommodations in the RPWD Act, which were not really mentioned in the RTE, you know. So I think that is where it really supports inclusion. The other thing that I really like is the emphasis on technology, which I think, you know, the technology has transformed so many fields and will transform education also, and definitely the disability sector. So, you know, emphasizing the push towards that is something that we really need. So that's something, again, the NEP does that is really great. I think the NEP, as it stands, is a document that that talks about the ideal, you know, where we want to be with inclusion. I wonder some of the challenges are going to come when it actually comes down to execution. And I think that, as somebody on the ground, those are some things that I have questions about. You know, the RPWD Act also with all its accommodations is fantastic, but what's actually the reality on the ground and how much has come to fruition? That is something that I think will have to be given paid careful attention to. I think one of the things that while the NEP talks about building capacity of teachers, it also talks about cross-disciplinary special educators, cross-disciplinary experts, which is fantastic. You know, I mean, that's what you should have, right? You should have people with a skill set to work across different disciplines, across maybe the entire definition of inclusion general classrooms. The thing is that this doesn't right now match with the training that educators are receiving. So the RCI, which is the Rehabilitation Council of India, that drives the teacher capacity building for special education in particular, right now has disciplinary specific courses. So in the past, it used to have multidisciplinary courses where educators were exposed to multiple types of disabilities. But right now, it has disciplinary specific courses. So, you know, be it in visual impairment, in learning disabilities, in intellectual disabilities, things like that. So with the NEP calling for cross-disciplinary special educators, I think that's going to take a while and a lot of thought on the execution to see how that will happen. And a lot of systems will have to be aligned for something like that to come about. I do think it's a great recommendation. I do think that the devil is in the details. You know, how is it suddenly going to happen? But I think it's a good plan to move towards. And I think this is something we should pay attention to. How do we build in cross-disciplinary experts? The other thing is a bit contentious. You know, the NEP, like the RPWD Act, offers students a choice of schooling. Now, this is not there in the RTE. RTE calls for full inclusion. So this, the RPWD Act and the NEP offer students, while it calls for inclusion, offers students a choice of schooling, either special schooling or homeschooling or neighborhood schools. Now, I, you know, as a practitioner on the ground, I'm torn because I appreciate this. I feel that that this recommendation really acknowledges the ground reality. Today, as we stand, we are not equipped to serve students effectively. All schools are not inclusive. And we are not equipped to serve students effectively in all settings. Now, I want to move towards inclusion, but the reality is I don't want a child today to suffer just because we haven't yet reached them. We don't have the systems to support them. So I think I appreciate that the recognition that, you know, that the child at the center, where the child the family gets to make a decision. But I think it leaves too much, it's too much ambiguity because there is no end. You know, there's no mention of, okay, by such and such date, we should move towards full inclusion, or by every school should have such and such prerequisites or resources. Minimum requirements to ensure that there is full inclusion for a child. And so there's no guidance on, you know, where the child, when should you opt for homeschooling? When should you opt for special schooling? And I think that it makes it very difficult for advocates on the ground. And I think that's where the challenges are going to be seen. You know, how does one advocate a child to be in a school and advocate for the services that you need? When also you have an option for special schooling and for homeschooling. So I think this is something that the NEP could have been clearer about, especially since it endorses full inclusion. But I think this is going to leave a lot of the field, you know, a bit unchanged, I think, from where we are currently today. And related to inclusion, Maitri, I think what you said, you know, rightly with the terminology. So I think that yes, there is a rights perspective and it comes across in many statements, but it's also a bit contradictory, you know. So in very many places, there's a mention of equipping students with a skill set to fit into the current existing system. So there is talk about changing. But there's also talk about equipping them with the skill set. And that, again, is back to a medical model where the fault lies with the student. So I think while the NEP does a good job of recognizing the rights perspective, I think it's not consistent. And that again leads to, you know, ambiguity. And I think the final point then that I'd like to talk about is the emphasis on, is a point that's brought up about identification of students with learning disabilities. So I'm glad for the NEP talking about learning disabilities. You know, learning disabilities for so long has not even been recognized as a disability. With the RPDWD Act coming in, it was recognized for the first time, which is fantastic. And the NEP acknowledges it as a widespread disability that needs to be focused on, and teachers need to be equipped to serve students. They also talk about teachers being equipped to identify students with disabilities. Now, that's good in the sense that teachers should be equipped with being able to recognize where the challenges are. But I think there's no mention about systemic changes there and school systems. You know, disabilities don't exist in isolation. They're context specific. And I think that's another thing that the NEP has not talked about enough, about the systemic change that we need. They mention school culture, but they don't talk about the organization as how the systems that the organization will have to put into place in order to support students. So then the identification is more organic. And then students who are, you know, just slightly falling below don't unnecessarily get identified and get categorized as labeled as having a disability, which is unfortunately what I feel could potentially happen if teachers are equipped to identify early. I think instead the emphasis, which the NEP does on foundational literacy, the emphasis should be on that, you know, saying how do we build in this foundational literacy, with the onus being on the system. On the system to recognize it, rather than saying that, you know, the child is not fitting in the system. So I think these are some of the challenges that I hope the plan of action is able to take into consideration. A little bit more clarity on how is this going to unfold? That's where I feel it's going to be a bit challenging. Maithili, what do you think?
Yeah, thank you, Radhika, for very clearly bringing out the problems with relation to practice when it comes to implementing inclusive education. So three points that you made stand out for me. So one, the teacher education part is very crucial. And the NEP has rightly addressed that at some length. And they also talk about equally important aspect of equipping the administrative workforce and orienting them for inclusion as well. But one aspect that is missing in this recommendation is the state's investment over a long term to implement the recommendation. So as you again very critically pointed out, we have to see if budgetary allocation is indeed made for this component. And the second related point that you again brought out, so cross-disability is something that many people have been advocating in the sector. So, but what is not clear in the NEP, which we hope again the program of action will be able to address, is the role of RCI and the courses that are being accredited by it. And you again very rightly pointed out that the structures required and the time needed for bringing about these changes are going to be substantial, and we need to keep that in mind. So, again, it's a very positive move forward in terms of recommending certificate courses both during the pre-service teacher education as well as part of the continuous professional development for working teachers to enable them for inclusion. So now it becomes the responsibility of the mainstream teacher and not just the special educator as is the case many a time currently. So another aspect is, that I wanted to also check with you, Radhika. So the recommendation about efforts to make curriculum and textbooks free of biases and cultivating respect for diversity. So that's indeed a very valuable suggestion to make in the policy document. But I feel it falls short of celebrating diversity and plurality, which is essentially what inclusion is about. Yes. What is your take on that?
Mithili, so that's where I'm seeing the confusion lies, you know. There is a rights perspective that comes in, but then it very often there are statements made that seem to lay the burden on the child and on the saying that something is different that needs to be, you know, equated. And I think that's where the challenge that you're talking about, you know, rather than celebrating neurodiversity, it's saying something needs to be changed so that you can access it, which I do also feel that there needs to be a little bit more consistency in that, in the celebration and recognition of inclusion as a right. And whoever you are, whatever whatever your characteristics, whoever you are, you have a right to be a part, and you have a right to be celebrated with all your uniqueness, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. So, which brings me to the second point that you made, Radhika, about the philosophy of inclusion itself. So basically, it means a system has to adapt. And as you pointed out, the act falls short of that. So somewhere there is this assumption that the individual learners will have to adapt to the system, which is the older integration model, in fact. At the institutional level, other than endorsing RPD Act, which in fact details out the roles and expectations from institutions to ensure rights are met, I think the action plan for the policy has to clearly spell out how these legal obligations will be enforced. And basically, I think it is important for all of us in the sector to really appreciate the fact that inclusion calls for systemic adoption and not the other way around, which will take us back, in fact, to integration.
Yes, and Mathali, you know, related to that, you're absolutely right. In fact, there is interchangeability like that has been used in these terms. You know, very often there's integration used right through the NEP, and then inclusion. And I think the terms, if I'm not mistaken, have been used interchangeably, which is not so. And I think that confusion really comes across then. What is our approach, you know, how are we viewing inclusion? And I think that change, you know, moving towards a dialogue of inclusion then will bring about those systemic changes rather than piecemeal, you know, band-aids, fixes, small fixes.
Absolutely. And I also really appreciate when you said that terms matter. So the vocabulary that we use, especially in the policy, can lead to a lot of confusion during interpretation. So it is absolutely essential that very clear about the kinds of terms that the policy uses and what they mean by it. So which comes to the question of labeling. So again, the policy has come up with a construct called socially and economically disadvantaged groups. And while it is commendable that, you know, it is attempting to synergize different efforts to address equity issues and lumping all of those categories under one umbrella construct, but at the same time, we have to remember that social justice theorists, for example, like Nancy Fraser, point out the crucial need for recognition and representation in addition to redistribution of resources. That is one point. And the other point is the effects of labeling itself, as you brought out, Radhika. In fact, some countries like Sweden, for example, have completely done away with labeling.
Mm-hmm. Well.
What is your thoughts on that. And basically, again, you brought it out, the aspect of the biopsychosocial model overcoming the... So the labeling essentially is based on a medical model of looking at disabilities, isn't it?
Very much so, Maitri. And I found that missing from the NEP, this recognition of it being context specific and how the environment creates the disability, you know. And I'm on the ground, so I'm well aware that there are challenges that students face. And, you know, I'm not ignoring the fact that there are differences and you know, we need to have unique ways of teaching, things like that. I am fully acknowledging that. But I think the, you know, if the focus stays on identification, as you said, and it segregates. And there's like a, you know, on the ground, when we give examples to teachers, often we talk about how, you know, one child is running around five times, but a child who, you know, has ADHD runs around six times, and then it's a problem. Like, they, you know, you're automatically tuned to pick up those challenges, the difficulties, just by virtue of that label. And that's a very cautious, like I read that part on identification, and it worried me, because again, it's saying that that, you know, the system is not serving, and that something is amiss with that child, rather than moving. It won't bring about the inclusion that we are envisioning if the focus is that, rather than strengthening our system, strengthening our resources and embracing it. The NEP, I think, does a good job of school culture. Like, I was glad to see that they mentioned the culture, but I think there needs to be more emphasis on that later down in the recommendations. I would have had that right up front, as that being the front and center conversation for everyone. Yeah.
Absolutely. So which brings me to the third point that you made, Radhika, about home-based education and special education. Although NEP does not directly talk about these aspects, but by endorsing RPWD Act, which in fact gives provision for special education, and the RTE Act also gives provision for home-based education.
Yes.
So essentially, we have three systems catering to children with disability in the country. So there is this argument being made by scholars that, one, you're frittering away the sparse resource that you have across these different provisioning. So that is the issue on the one hand. But on the other hand, again, you pointed out very rightly so that on the ground, things are quite complex. And when the system is not yet ready for full inclusion, then there is merit in having other options as well. And some advocacy groups, for example, do in fact strongly emphasize the need for special schools, especially at the elementary level. Would you agree to that stance of the groups?
Yes, I think I recognize, and often these groups are parent-driven, Maitri. You know, in several focus groups with parents in the organization that I work, and other ones too that I've heard, they strongly advocate. And it's interesting, because you have parents who are strongly advocating for inclusion, but parents who strongly advocate for their children to have an option of special schooling. As I said, I get it, you know. I don't think it's clear enough on where we want to go, you know. So I think that direction would have been good coming from them. So, you know, are we just saying, is the status quo, you know, is it just going to stay as is, because we have these options available? So are we just going to continue to grow like that, or is there a goal towards, if we're saying we're ratifying inclusion, if we're saying we're moving towards that, then what's the path towards that? So I think that is, that's where my concerns come in with these choices.
Yes, so that is a crucial point that you just made. So as a country, what is our vision for inclusion? So are we saying that we accept inclusion but with certain caveats, or are we philosophically and also through our the way we show our concern, especially at the state level, is by resource allocation and how we concentrate our energy into making it happen. So I think it is really important for all of us, not just the policymakers, but also those of us who are engaged in the sector, to really reflect on this deeply and see where is it that we want to go. Are we really accepting complete inclusion? And in which case, I think we have to all move in that direction more cohesively. And at the same time, also lobby with the state for greater investment towards inclusion.
Yeah, I think, as you said, the program of action has to, well, I mean, you're talking about heavy investment in, like, you know, best practices, learning really what works. We don't know that on the ground, frankly. We don't know how to make inclusion. It's very challenging world over. I mean, it's very challenging to achieve that. And so I think we have to look and set a reasonable path, like a practical path of how to make it happen. That's something that is going to take a lot of time and energy. And I think we need a vision ahead, as you said, you know, rightly, we need that. And then we can start chalking out how to get there.
Exactly. And we all recognize that in a country as diverse as India, and with so many different needs, not just across states, but even within localities itself. So that being the case, there cannot be one path, but I think a cohesive vision is something that is important. And that's exactly the reason why there has to be more flexibility. I think the NEP does allow for that kind of flexibility, but then we'll have to be, again, look out for the program of action and see how they interpret that flexibility on the ground. So flexibility should not translate into either a sab kuch chalta hai kind of an attitude, or in the other extreme, interpreting it to mean a bouquet of options, but in terms of a very rigidly defined structures for that.
Yeah.
So broadly, the 13 recommendations under this particular section of inclusion, most of them talk about the systemic, at the systemic level, so which is in fact, quite crucial. But then, as we discussed just now, so somewhere there is this assumption also that the onus is on the individual learner to make adaptations as well. So it would have really helped if that had come across quite strongly in terms of the system making adaptation for complete inclusion. So what I particularly liked about the very first recommendation is identifying education as a tool for forging an inclusive society. So this certainly gives one a very powerful message of hope. But at the same time, you know, there has to be the critical awareness that formal education has long been a vehicle for perpetuating the larger inequities in society as well.
Yeah.
What do you think of?
I mean, I think the vision is there, that I think it starts with, if the messages come across, I I think then the goal is to how do you give access to everybody also, right? But I appreciate that that formal education and education, the dialogue starts there, celebrating diversity. So that's the, if you know, if at the system level, if that's what we're looking at, then that's a great recommendation. But how to access it, I think that's going to be the challenge, right?
Yeah, that is the challenge, and also this lack of cohesive vision even within the document for complete inclusion.
No, 100%. I think that's where, sorry, Maithili, I lost you for a second with this, but I think that's a big concern. I think that they appreciate, as I said, you know, I appreciate that they're talking about and, you know, changing the culture, changing the conversation, celebrating things like that. But as you get deeper, you know, there are inconsistencies which I think could be ironed out if it was to ensure the cohesive vision.
Yeah. So, and also the acknowledgement that state efforts and policy formulations have so far not been adequate to address equity issues in education, I think is again a crucial first step towards redressal. So let's hope that, you know, the program of action that is designed to implement the policy, as you said, is able to iron out these contradictions and is able to come up with a more cohesive vision and again flexibility, true flexibility in the sense of the term, with adequate checks and balances, of course. So one last point that I wanted to discuss was the special education zones. So again, you know, focused on target schemes and incentives such as hospital scholarships and setting up of these SEZs are definitely desirable, but again, they stop short, you know, they will be of limited reach and can at most help create islands of excellence. So once again, we come back to the first point that we began with, that a concerted effort and substantial resources will be needed to make the entire system inclusive. And more importantly, Radhika, as you pointed out, research in terms of what works and what doesn't work and build on that. We really have very little to go by within the country in terms of how inclusion works actually in context, what are the challenges, and more importantly, how do teachers address those challenges within their own spaces?
Yeah. And I think, Maithili, you're right in that call. Like, you know, the NEP does, as a document, I think we're on the right path. You know, they've taken steps towards it. I think it does fall short, but I do think that it is, you know, if the, as you said, a program of action can be detailed, and it's not going to be an easy journey, but I think if it can be more explicit about steps and lay out, you know, as you said, resource allocation, things like that, I think it could be a powerful, lead to some powerful change.
Absolutely. Yeah. So on that note, we will conclude this discussion. So we've certainly come a very long way in terms of thinking of inclusion, and we still have a long way to go, but I'm glad that we've made a beginning, and this policy helps us to open up dialogues regarding that, and also possibilities, very real possibilities in terms of inclusion. So on that note, we will end the discussion. Thank you very much, Radhika. It was a pleasure listening to you and understanding the complexities from the sector's point of view, from the ground.
Thank you, Mathily. Likewise, it was a pleasure having, thank you, having this conversation. Thank you.